afternoon, everyone, and welcome. This is dashboarding with big data, and hopefully, you know, one of those keywords makes some sense to you guys. Otherwise, it's likely you're in the wrong room. So my name is Bernie, and I'm a senior software developer at Geotab.
I'm Gordon from Geotab, and I'm also a software developer.
So in the next half hour or so, we'll be showcasing what we've been working on for the past year or so. And we'll be giving you guys kind of an inside look at some of the new storytelling features that you'll find in my Geotab. So we'll begin with a really brief introduction. What's a dashboard, and why do we need them? Then we'll go over some of the cool features that we have in these new dashboards. We'll follow that up with a couple of demos, kind of highlighting those talked about features. And then we'll see what's in store for the future, and then answer any questions you might have. So before I begin, I just want to give you guys some quick facts. The common theme for this year's Connect is obviously data, right? And I think it's no surprise when I say that we collect truckloads of data. Yeah, that was pun intended. Okay, so we collect 1.2 million devices now. Neil updated this morning. And across those 1.2 million active devices, we collect a staggering 2.1 billion records per day. That's billion with a capital B. So what does this mean? Well, as Neil would say, if you do the math, that's about 2,000 records per device per day. Which, on its own, it's not too crazy, not too much. But imagine if you have a fleet size of, of a modest, even 50 vehicles. That innocent 2,000 records now, skyrockets to 100,000 records. And then if you extrapolate that over the course of a year, that becomes 36 million records per year. And that is, that's a lot of data to work with. So I just want to share a little tidbit of information I found. There was a study conducted by some researchers at 3M, and they found that humans process visuals 60,000 times faster than text, and that visuals themselves also improve learning by up to 400%. So I think these two numbers really, really encourage the need for data visualizations and ultimately dashboards as well, too. All right, so the question we want to answer is, what's a dashboard? Why do we need them? Why are we up here talking to you guys about this stuff? First of all, to put it simply, dashboards are a tool to visualize data. They're used to monitor trends, so you can see the highs and lows of your fleet. And they're also used to uncover relationships, between, seemingly unrelated variables at most times. For example, you could be looking at, during the Christmas time, there's a seasonal trend, right? And that usually results in, an increase of delivery vehicles. And with that increase of delivery vehicles, you can find, an increase of, certain driver behaviors. And I think the most important thing about dashboards, and really the thing that sets them apart from, say a static image or a, even some other dashboarding platforms, is that these new dashboards, they're interactive. They're meant to be used as a tool to dive into your data and to really investigate it. And ultimately, you let your data speak for itself and kind of tell its own story. Okay, so enough of me trying to convince you guys that what we're doing is a very necessary thing. I'm going to pass it on to Gordana, and she's going to talk about some of the cool features that we have in these new dashboards.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here and to talk about some interesting features we developed for creating functional dashboards. I really think those features are great, and I really hope you will find them as useful as we do. So one of the main features we have is the ability to organize widgets into rows and columns. We found that this is a really easy way for users to lay out their dashboards with just a few clicks. So let me prove you how easy it is. So here we have a dashboard with three widgets, the text, an image, and a chart. They're all stacked one after another in a single column and one row. If I click on this icon here, I will get some rows options, like add row, delete row, and number of columns. Let's pay attention on number of columns. So let's say we want to change number of columns from 1 to 2. We can do this pretty easy. I think this was really easy and just a couple of clicks, as I said. Now that we have this extra column, let's make a use of this white space. We can drag and drop whatever widget we want. So, of course, the real thing is much more smooth, and it's really that easy. A dashboard is nothing without some content. So we have three different widget types to add this content. So we have text, which supports different style options like color, font, alignment, and et cetera. Then we have images, which can be inserted via a URL. And we support the most standard web images, including SVGs. Last but not least, we have charts that represent the most popular and the most important dashboard widgets. So we can do as usual stuff as you would expect. Like we can edit, copy, and delete the widget. If we click on the pencil icon, we will open up a widget editor. Here you can change everything related to your widget, like really everything. You can change the data you want to look at. You can change how you want to aggregate the data or how you want to sort the data, like really, really everything related to the widget. Let's take a quick look at our charts library. So we have lots of different options. So we have column and bar. They both can be stacked. Then we have a line chart. We also have a pie chart. Then we have a table. We also have digital gauge, which supports different color ranges, which is very useful for scores. Next, I'm going to talk about some features we developed for data diving. The first one is filters. So let's take a look at trips and at the dashboard that represents some trips and exception statistics, like distance, duration, across 5 months period. But what if we want to look at data for only 1 month? Or we want to look at data for only specific devices? Well, we can do this pretty easy, as everything else so far, by just applying some of filters. We can open filters by clicking on the icon in top right corner. And the first filter we will see is the date range filter. So this is pretty much the most common filter you will guys use. Besides date range filter, we also have other filters like year, month, week of year, and many more. And of course, we can filter data on devices, which I think is really important. So those were dashboard filters. But we also have filters that we can apply on each chart separately. So let's say you wanna have two charts looking at the same data for 2 different months. You can do so. You can just add a month filter. So imagine this now. You're creating a dashboard. You're adding some pretty cool charts. And you're applying some filters. And you came across something very neat, or you came across something very interesting that you might want to share or you want to come back to later. You don't want to lose what you currently created or what you found. But at the same time, you don't want to stop playing with your data. So what can you do? Well, this is the reason we created something called snapshots. And yes, it's exactly how it sounds. You are taking a picture, not literally with your phone or a camera, but yes, you are taking a picture of your dashboard. So this way, you can keep doing whatever you were doing. And if you came across something interesting, just take another snapshot, right? It's easy. Now, on to my favorite feature, which is drill throughs. I really think this feature is great. Like, this is something that sets dashboards apart from just the static charts or other dashboarding solutions. Like the main idea behind those dashboards is to tell a story. Like it's to encourage you guys to dive into your data, to go deep into your data. So here we have two dashboards. Appropriately, but not really creatively named, dashboard one with the most active vehicles, with the list of most active vehicles, and dashboard two with some safety exception metrics and their global breakdown. So the story we might want to tell, or actually the question we might want to ask, is what one of those vehicles from this list did to be on the to be on this list. So let's say we take, for example, a Stella vehicle, which is on the third place on the list. So what this Stella vehicle did to be on the third place of the list of most active vehicles? To answer this question, we can just click on the bar that represents the data for the Stella vehicle and see how the dashboard 2 will be updated. If you take a look at dashboard 2, dashboard 2 now contains the data related to the vehicle we clicked on. So those are data only for Stella vehicle. Pretty awesome, right? Of course, this is just a simple example. Like this is just to give you guys an idea of what you can do. And I really encourage you to dive into the data, to go deep into your data, to tell your story. Like you have an option to add multiple drill throughs. So use that option. Tell your story. Go deep into your data, and I really hope you like this feature. Like, I really think it's great, and I really think it's really useful. Now, Bernie will tell you something about my Geotab integration.
All right. Okay. A lot of features. So, on to the less exciting, but still very necessary stuff. So these new dashboards will be an add-in. For the time being, and they're installed using the same snippet of code that you'd expect to use to install any other add-in. They make use of the groups filter that you're already very accustomed to in MyGeotab. So, for example, if you're grouping on the regions, or if you're filtering by the regions group, you'll see that reflected in your dashboards as well. And of course, the dashboards will only use the data you're allowed to see. And this is very important, right? If I'm a driver and I have limited access to data, my dashboard is going to look a lot different and probably a lot less exciting than, say, Gordana's, who could be a fleet manager. And finally, some other integrations we have are related to the user. We take the user's their time zone, language preference, and date formats into account as well. So we currently support two different data sources. The first is the MyGeotab API, and the second are the MyGeotab Excel reports. I think the thing that's important here is that the data never leaves MyGeotab, and it's housed in MyGeotab and never leaves MyGeotab. So what's great about that is that whenever data is updated in MyGeotab, it's also updated on our dashboards as well. So with the API, we're currently collecting both trips and exceptions. So you can expect to see stuff like speeding distance, idling duration, seatbelt infractions, and so on. And then with the Excel reports, we've handpicked a few report templates that we found were important and perhaps the most popular. So you can expect to see exception summary, risk management, trips detail, trip summary, and watchdog reports. And with each one of these report types, we've also included their respective templates. And I'll be demoing or showing you guys some of this stuff in the demo. All right, so enough talk. Let's put our words into action and we'll show you guys some demos. We'll start with Gordana. She's gonna show you guys how to create a dashboard from the MyGeotab API.
Sorry about this. It's just easier for us.
Top one.
Here. Okay. So let's see some of the features we were talking about on a real dashboard, on a real example. So here we have a dashboard with only one widget that says pretty much nothing. So all I can see here is that this widget represents some data for 5 months period, but I really cannot tell which data. And on the first place, this chart is not evenly sorted well. So let's fix this. Let's open a widget editor, which I mentioned before. And as I said before, we can change everything related to our widget. So the first thing I really want to change is this sorting. So let's sort this chart by name. Here, if we take a look at this part here, at the data sources, we can actually see that this chart represents sum of incident counts for 4 exceptions per month, which is pretty cool, but not really useful. What I actually want to see is how many times each of these exceptions happened. So I want to see which exception happened the most. Right, so I can do this very easy by just grouping those, charts per exception. If I save the widget, now actually I have 4 bars, and each bar represents the exception we had in our image editor, which is pretty cool. But I wish I can actually tell which chart represents which exception. Like, I see some nice colors, but which color is related to which chart? To which exception? I can do that pretty easy. I can just show the legends. Well, now we can actually see that the exception that happened the most is seatbelt exception. Let's add one more exception. Let's see how our dashboard will be updated. So let's add, for example, speeding exception. It's usually pretty interesting. Whoa, this is interesting. This is a lot of speeding. Like, we have more speeding than any other exception. Actually, I think this is more speeding than all exceptions combined. Before I move on, I want to add some really small, like not some small options, but I still think pretty important options, like axis title. Let's add those titles. So month, number of incidents, and just to not forget what this chart is about, let's add a title. I'll just copy this title. I don't want to spend some time typing here because I have lots of things to show you guys, much more interesting stuff than typing. Well, those are some really small features, small options, but I really think useful options. Because they tell us more about this chart. Like, they tell us more what this chart is about. So we have some interesting chart here, but our dashboard doesn't seem that interesting. So it looks pretty boring and sad with only just one widget. So let's add more widgets. Let's add, for example, a text widget. I'll copy the text again. Nice, but I don't like this black color. It's so default. Let's change it to blue, Geotab blue. And let's change the font since we are here. Much nicer, right? Since I'm here, let's add one more widget. Let's add an image widget. I'll just copy the URL. Here we have some image. It's pretty nice that we added more widgets, but they're really not well organized. I want to organize them better. So let's add a row. I hope this looks familiar from the slides. So let's add a row below. And let's split this row to two columns. And let's move those two widgets into those two columns. And let's move this row here. Let's make them a bit bigger. As I said, it's easy. It's really easy, guys. Trust me. So here we have one chart for exceptions. Let's add one chart for trips. For example, I want to compare distance driving during the work hours and after work hours. And I want to do that on a pie chart. So let's split this row on two columns. And let's add a pie chart. So we are adding data sources from, the data source is MyGeoTab. We are adding a pie chart. Let's copy the title again. Chart data would be trip, chart data items, work driving duration, and after hours driving duration. And let's aggregate by sum, for example. So here we have a pie chart. And I would say this was pretty much expected. Like, people are driving more during the work hours than after work hours. To finish this dashboard, let's add one more widget. Let's add let's add live widgets that represent safety exceptions per hour of day. I will do this in a new row. So we are adding a new widget. Data source is again MyGeoTab. As I said, line. Let's copy the title again. Chart data would be exception now. Chart data items would be harsh braking, harsh cornering, and hard acceleration. Data measure would be incident count. Group by would be hour of day, and then exception. Aggregate by, let's do some again. So before I tell anything about this chart, I want to sort this chart. Sort by name, and let's show the legends again. Let's show them at the bottom now. And if I actually want to see something, I have to make this chart bigger. Well, so here we see that the activities increase around 8 a.m. I guess people are rushing to get to work. Also, activities increases around 1 p.m. I guess people are rushing to grab food during the lunch break. And activities especially increases around 5 p.m. I guess we are just all rushing to get home as soon as possible, and I don't blame you guys. So we started with some really basic dashboard, with some chart that didn't mean nothing. And now we actually have some still simple dashboard, but I would say nice looking dashboard. And we have some interesting charts here. We have some interesting statistics here, some interesting and useful statistics. I hope you like the dashboard I created, and I hope you will have opportunity to create the same dashboards and much more interesting dashboards as well. Now I'm going to pass to Bernie, who will show you some other interesting dashboards.
All right, thank you. Okay, so the next demo I want to walk through is it's going to showcase how we use the MyGeoTab Excel reports in our dashboards. So before I get into that, I just want to show you guys, you know, really just a report template for a driver safety scorecard. as you can see, It's broken down by vehicle, or maybe you can't see this, but it's broken down by vehicle on the left here. And with it are some stats like, you know, distance in kilometers, there's a total score, there's a scoring classification, and then there's like a general breakdown of the scores, the score parts, if you will. And in this case, you know, this report template is, it's actually quite nice looking. It's you know, your typical Excel report is just going to be, you know, black and white and just a, you know, a series of rows and columns. But even though it's nice looking, I think we can do better. So with that, this is the dashboard that we have previously created for, you know, ahead of time. And it's using that same Excel report as a data source. So you can see here we have total kilometers, total distance in kilometers. We have total incidents and this, that same score I was talking about before, right? And I think, and actually down here, we also have a couple more line charts. They're both using the API to pull exceptions. So I think the thing to note here is that a dashboard doesn't have to be driven by only one data source. We can actually, you know, combine, we can actually pull data from multiple sources and then combine them into a single dashboard. Really, each individual chart pulls its own data, and we're using the dashboard to amalgamate them all together. All right, so I'm just going to show you guys how we create a chart from the report templates. It's as easy as what Gordana just showed you guys. So we're going to add a chart. Instead of choosing my geotab, now we're now choosing my geotab report. And we're going to pick the same safety scorecard as our report type, or as our template. So we're going to go into risk management. We're going to look for the report template that we used. And we're looking at on a vehicle basis. And these exceptions are pre-populated by default because the report relies on those rules. So we don't need to we don't need any additional user input for the rules. So we click next. Let's say we want to create a pie graph, and we're going to be looking at the breakdown of what's the safety classification, or the scoring classification. Sorry. All right. So we just choose. We're going to group by that same scoring calculation, and we're going to aggregate by account. We're going to create that chart. And of course, that's too small. So let's just make this a bit bigger. Well, that's very surprising. So I guess for this period of time, you know, all the drivers were of a medium risk, which is a, you know, it's a good sign because there is a high risk classification and there are no high risk drivers. So that is how we generally how we use. The reports, the Excel reports, to feed a dashboard and to feed the charts. The next, actually no, there's more of that. one of the things I get the most from clients is about calculations, and how they can add their own calculations and see it on a dashboard. So, you know, we thought. You know, what better way to do this than to utilize, you know, Excel? You know, there's no point in reinventing the wheel. Excel already has a very powerful calculation engine, so we might as well make use of it. So in the center here, we see a widget for total distance in kilometers, you know, which is very Canadian-friendly. But I know we have a lot of American friends in here, so let's make this dashboard, you know, more American-friendly. So if we just go back to the report, we have that distance kilometer we can see right here. And we want to add an additional column. And say we want to add, you know, a distance in miles instead. So I'm just going to type this in, distance in miles. And the calculation, I'm just going to copy. So this calculation is just, it's very simple. It's looking at the the distance in kilometers column and multiplying it by the known conversion factor. Let's try that again. There we go. So let me just drag that down and update the report, and we can save this report as a brand new template. Let's label that correctly so I don't forget what I'm working with. In miles, saved. So now all we need to do to make use of this new template is to re-upload it back into my geotab. So I want to re-upload it on top of the existing report template that I had edited before. Let's just take that, drop it in there, and save it. Oh, I'm sure it's saved. And now if we come back here and we can just open up this editor, or this editor for this chart. And it was looking, it may be hard to see, but this says distance in kilometers. Let's just delete that, and let's add our newly inserted column, which is distance in miles. All right? And, you know, for the sake of consistency, let's change our title to say total distance in miles. We save that. And of course, it says zero. That is strange. Anyways, that should update. That should update appropriately. I've done it a million times. I don't know what's going on here right now, but yeah, exactly. Use your imagination, right? Everyone do the math. It's fairly easy. All right, so let's go back into our driver safety scorecard. Sorry, let me just take care of something here. And this is why. Oh, wow. OK. Just keep using your imagination, please. And bear with me. OK, that's better. OK, so that's how we use calculations from Excel. I promise you, it's a lot smoother than that. This always happens, of course, when it's live. But anyways, that's how we use Excel reports. The next thing I want to showcase is how we have some of the data diving features in our dashboards, namely drill throughs. So down here we have a table that's looking at pretty much the exact same data that we were looking at in the Excel report. Perhaps not as colorful, but it would be nice if you could drill into each individual row and, you know, see more data regarding each vehicle. So let's see how that's set up. Let's open up the editor. And of course, there's already one set up, but let's just delete that. So here we're creating some actions that will happen on each row of data. So let's add an action. And some of the actions we can do are open a dashboard, open a URL, or show a tooltip. You know, for the sake of this demo, let's open a dashboard. And we want to open it on a click. And then the dashboard we want to open is the detailed driver safety scorecard. So that's all set up. Close that. Save. And then now that drill through is set up. So, you know, if we click on one of these vehicles, we can see a drill through. So, you know, let's click on this vehicle. It says dispatch MM1 MMC. And there we have it. This is a brand new dashboard that we've drilled into from that one vehicle. And you can see up here, it says detailed driver safety scorecard. And it's looking at information and data for that one vehicle alone. You can see stuff like total distance, total incidents. There are score again, a couple line charts. Another interesting line chart, you know, there's a huge spike in the morning. They must be notorious for being late or something, I don't know. And then is a general breakdown of exceptions for that one device. And this table here also you know, tells that fact. There's only one device that we're looking at. And as we had mentioned previously, you know, you can drill through to another drill through, and you can keep drilling through. So I can show you that in action. So let's open up this editor again for the table report. And we can see that there's already been an action set up for it. So the action this time is opening a URL. So in addition to opening a dashboard on a click, we can also open, say, a URL. A nice example would be if we could drill into the trips history report in my geotab. So we have that URL pasted in this box here. So then what happens when we click on this this vehicle is that it'll take us into my geotab, into the trips history report, and it's looking only at dispatch, that one vehicle, dispatch MM1 MMC, and it's looking at the exact same time range that we were looking at previously in the dashboards. So that concludes the demos that we had for you guys. Let's go back to this. Oops, not quite there yet. Okay. There's something happening here. A ghost. Okay, so let's see what's in store for the future. So these dashboards will be released in the near future, shortly, and they will be a beta release. You know, I think what we have here is pretty cool, it's pretty powerful, but I feel like we've only, you know, scratched the surface of what we can do. So here are some of the things that we do plan on doing in the future. First and foremost, we want more widgets and more chart types. I think what we're currently offering is, you know, it's kind of like a base package for charts. We want to offer, you know, a premium set of charts, free of course, that, you know, really enhance your dashboard and really make it look, you know, visually appealing and, you know, tell a really great story. We want to have some tighter integrations with MyGeotab, you know, some integration with big data. You know, with all the talk about big data these days, I think it only makes sense to leverage, you know, those storage solutions and to you know, have big data, you know, feed a lot of our charts, you know, and a lot of our dashboards. And last but not least, we want to be able to use more data sources. I think it'd be great if someone could upload their own data source, you know, whether it's like a CSV file or a JSON file, and then have that external data, you know, enrich the MyGeotab data and, you know, have it shown on a dashboard. So that concludes our breakout session. We want to thank you guys for listening, and I guess we'll answer some questions.
Sure. Do you just want to start with the link first, and we can go to the audience
sure.
questions?
So, are dashboards visible to other users? Dashboards will be visible to, I think, so there's a concept of, I guess, sharing, or not sharing, but visibility. So you'll be able to create dashboards which are private to yourself, and then visible to your team. Only, well, not your team, but to your database, if you will. They won't be shared across databases. Of course, that would be perhaps a violation of data security. What data is included? So currently we're doing status data, not status, we're doing trips data and exceptions data, as well as any data that you can get from the MyGeotab Excel reports. And I also believe that there are some some of the reports are fed through big data, if I'm not mistaken. Can current versions, so the next question is, can current versions support big databases greater than 5,000 vehicles? So this dashboarding solution is primarily focused for, smaller to medium-sized businesses. 5,000 vehicles is would post to be, quite a bit of data, and this might not be the best solution for that. There are definitely others that I think like a Redash or maybe a Power BI that can leverage big data to really showcase that data. Is this planned to be an add-in? Sorry, the next question is this planned to be an add-in or part of the base product? And to begin, it is going to be an add-in and separate from the dashboards that you find currently in MyGeoTab. And the last question is, how can we start using these tools? Well, once we announce a beta release, the installation process will be fairly simple. It's just it's a matter of copying a snippet of code and then inserting that code into the administration or the add-in component inside the administration portion of MyGeoTab.
Okay.
More questions?
I sent a couple in, but I don't think I loaded.
Okay.
Thank you. The snapshot feature, can it actually revert the version of the report back to it? Maybe I was messing around too much, and now I don't have the same report I started with.
Answer that one? Or?
Sure. depends what are you doing on. Actually, it depends what are you doing on your dashboard. Like, for example, if you are changing filters, they won't be saved. Like, if you're creating, I talked about snapshots. So if you are playing with your data and I don't know, adding different filters, and they will be saved into a snapshot. Actually, they won't be saved into a snapshot. You can decide if you want to save. But the changes you're doing on your dashboard are automatically saved. Like, for example, as a Google Drive. You are adding some text or images or whatever, and it's automatically saved. So you pretty much cannot go back. But I think in future, we are planning to do some different versions as Google does, so you can actually go back to your data. So right now, you cannot really go back to your data.
I think one thing to note is that when you create a snapshot, you're creating another view of the same dashboard, right? But you're not actually updating that dashboard. So your original dashboard remains intact. It doesn't change, but your snapshot will. And that snapshot just looks at that dashboard and has its own little filters and modifications, but the original will still remain. So you can always go back to the original dashboard, but not so much your original snapshot. Yeah. I think there's a question in the back there.
Yeah.
Oh, and up front here too.
Can you overlay thresholds or trend data or goal data? Like if you have incidences that you want to stay below, or if you're a division and you have a corporate trend and you want to see where you rank, or are you able to overlay data that's not specific to that particular file?
Yeah, I see what you mean.
Yeah.
I think
just a benchmark for the company.
Right.
Or how are you trending for a 200 moving day average kind of thing?
Mm-hmm. I think, at this point, you can't do that. But a way to accommodate that would be to, if your Excel report, if you added that additional metric as a column in your Excel report, then you could chart across those three items that you were mentioning. I don't know if that answers the question, but. Then I guess no.
Maybe in future, not for now.
Yeah, at this moment, it would be a no. But yeah.
Like right now, this is pretty much the first phase of this product, and we are planning to do many more stuff. Like as Bernie said in the future plans slide, we are really planning to do a lot of stuff here. So this is pretty much just the first phase, and this is actually first time we are talking about this in public.
But I mean, at the same time, you bring up a good point because we want to hear feedback from customers,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And what features are the most important? So, mean, we can certainly note down your use case.
And I think you could probably create another column to do, like, incidents per mile or per 1,000 miles.
Yeah.
Instead of, because it's a lot of incidences, but is it reflective of the number of kilometers or miles driven by mm-hmm. that driver?
Right.
You know, there are a lot of drivers who might have a lot more incidences, but he also has a lot more drive, miles.
Right, exactly, yeah. So usually we normalize that per, say, like, 100 kilometers or 100 miles, so that the score is, you know, based on how much you do drive.
Yeah. We have a question in the back row.
Can you, if you run this dashboard on a weekly or monthly basis, capture it as a PDF and send it via email?
Currently, no. Okay. PDFs are generally a pretty difficult problem. Not to say we can't do it, but at this point, if you want to print the dashboard, you would print it from, say, Chrome or your browser. PDFing it would be, something that comes in the future.
That is definitely on our list, to-do list.
I was just wondering if there's a way to export out these dashboards so that they can be shared amongst different databases.
Mm-hmm.
So, for instance, we have a whole bunch of different end users that might want to use this style, but without us recreating that dashboard
right.
each time or them having to do it on their own, is there
yep.
a way to do that?
Yep. I mean, at this point, it's not exposed, but all the dashboards, they're created in, this is getting kind of technical, but they're created in a JSON format. So it would be easy enough to download that JSON and re-upload it into another database. And, you know, provided that the dashboard uses the, some standard exceptions, like speeding or whatnot, then that dashboard would work out of the box. But if it had the custom exceptions or custom rules, then you just have to load it and maybe just, you know, modify that report to look at whatever exception you're interested in. So the answer is partly yes.
So maybe you can expose that later?
Yes, yeah. I mean,
I mean, as it is, we have to help build the reports for most of our end users. They're usually not to the level that they can do a lot of that stuff with Excel by themselves. I
okay.
Mean, mm-hmm. I don't see them recreating this stuff by themselves either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, the dashboards themselves don't contain any, private information.
No, but it's that format that you're
yeah, exactly. So,
using it, right?
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, it totally makes sense that it can be exported and downloaded and used elsewhere. Yep.
Thank you.
One more,
I guess.
Yep.
One okay. more. Uh-huh.
Just kind of on that note, how customizable is it going to be to edit those dashboards as far as maybe changing what kind of bar graphs and what it actually looks like? I do know, like, some of my customers, they want to make sure that it looks this specific way,
mm-hmm.
So I just want to make sure, is that maybe possible or in the works?
Definitely possible. It would have to be, put in some kind of priority list of what features are the most important for customers. For me, I think customizing components of a dashboard and how it looks is very important. Everyone wants to see a dashboard, differently than others. And yeah, like you said, they want to see it, in a very specific fashion. And
We are also planning to add some global style options. So actually, users will have more options for styles. I guess that's the
Or like theme, themes as well,
like
too.
Theme,
like
theme,
you know,
yeah.
Dark theme, light
yeah.
theme, yeah.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
really cool.
Yeah.
Do that.
All right, you got one. Right,
one
go.
More onto the list.
Yeah. All right, well, thank you guys for coming. We're in booth one down on the floor. So if you guys have any additional questions, just drop by and we'll be there.
Thank you guys.